for giving the cordial welcome. Thank you. Very happy morning to all on board. A wonderful day to start with a kickstart to be, we say rather. It's really wonderful that beautiful topic. Humor in literature during the postmodern era. I think it's a wonderful topic. Secretary Dr. Vijay Raghavan and the convener of the program, Dr. Rajkumar, has selected for us. We are going to have a wonderful day with our resource person of the day, Dr. Monica from MDS Haryana. So I would like to welcome and thank the resource person of the day, half of the management, principal, members of staff and students of Nehru Arts and Science College. Welcome you, Dr. Monica, madam, and thank you so much for accepting the invitation and being with us, enlighten us with your thoughts.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am, for giving me this platform to express my opinions on the current topic.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. So humor, it is always in picture. And now that we are going to take that in a different perspective date, and I think more Dr. Mona enlighten us on the topic which she has accepted. So I'm not taking much time. Thanks to all the on board and welcome the participants. I always used to say that it is because of you we were able to succeed. This is our webinar series of the pandemic era. This is the second series which we have crossed 16 webinars, national and international level. This is our 16th webinar which we are into. So it's all because of the support which we are getting from the participants of colleges from in and out India. And we have international level participants also who are joining with us. So it's in between, I've got a call. I'm sorry. Thank you all, and over the end.
Thank you, ma'am.
I am profusely elated to take this opportunity to invite our resource person of the day, Dr. Monica Glenn, Assistant Professor, Department of English, MDST Girls College, Ambla City, Haryana. It's our responsibility as well as our needs to further add our knowledge resource person's of teaching. For this, I am Devendra, Assistant Professor, Department of English for Indra. Welcome you, sir.
Good morning, Vinny. Good morning, everyone. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Dr. Devendra.
Am I audible?
Yes, yeah, Dr. Devendra, you are
clear. Good morning, everyone. And yes, yes. Good morning, everyone. It is a great pleasure for introduce our speaker, Dylan. Today, about the humorous as a form of resistance, understanding the postmodern perspectives. And madam was completed her BA in 2009 from Kushti, Haryana, and she completed a MA 2011 Department of English, Punjab University, Chandigarh, with the first rank, and MPhil 12 Department of Punjab University, Chandigarh, and even third rank bit there in MPhil 12. And madam has cleared NET June 2012 UGC NET National Eligibility Test, PhD. In her PhD 2009, Punjab University, Chandigarh. And she was worked as assistant professor in English in Maharani Lakshmi Bai College in Haryana from 2013 to 2013. And she worked as an assistant professor of English and college and Chandigarh from 24-10-2013 to 28-2-2014. Worked as assistant professor Chaudhary Rabir Singh University, Haryana, and worked as assistant professor faculty department of evening study disciplinary research center in Punjab University from 2018 to 4-5-2018, and worked as assistant professor department of English MCM BAV called Women, Chandigarh from 6-7-2019 to 4-2019, and worked as assistant professor department of English PG Government College for Girls, Chandigarh from 14-12-2019 to 13-7-2020, and working as assistant professor regular and department of English MDSD Girls College, Ambala City, Haryana from 14-7-2022, and published many papers in international level, and she has published 2 national index referee journal, and she published 12 papers in international journal. International journal. Madam has published 2 books also, and book title is A Myth and Submission. Subversion of intertextuality in Gita Hariharan, The Thousand Faces of Night When Dreams Travel, and Learner Autonomy and Self Individual. She has published 2 books, and Madam has wait and presented a conference and seminars, and even she has active in and other organizing activities also. Working as a member of Literary Society, MDS, Ambala City, Haryana. As a girls' hostel, Chandigarh. Chandri Robin Singh University from 13-1-2009-2016. And worked as a secretary in academic affairs. And worked in coordinator and public relations officer. Worked as a member in organizing committee for inter-university. Held in CR campus, and worked as a member of various organization committees and events like universities, friends, and other academic cultural activities, and was an organizing secretary 1 week DGHE sponsored national workshop on skills and professional grooming from 8-6-2016 to 16-6-2016, and served as an in-charge and department of English CRSU Jane for 2 consecutive years, and she also member of Society for Multi-Ethnic Literature of the World, life member of Shakespeare Association in India, and she received a certificate, appreciation certificate received from the Warden Amita Prim Hall Girls Hostel number 9 Punjab University South Campus, and appreciation certificate received from the Chairperson Department of English 9-11-2015 for extraordinary service and rendered for organizing and conduct of inter university quiz competition held by Department of English CRSU Jain University campus on November 9, 2015, and we are very grateful to Dr. Monica Dillon for accepting our invitation and marking her presence here. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Devendran, for introducing me to this webinar. And first of all, am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
First of all, I would like to congratulate the Department of English Arts and Science Colleges for organizing the series of webinars, because it is not a child's task to organize 16 webinars. So I would like to congratulate Dr. Malpi, Dean of the School of Arts and Sciences, for this gigantic task. And I would like to congratulate the organizing team for organizing these webinars for students of law, so that they can learn new. And I express gratitude to Dr. D. Vijay Raghavan for inviting me on this platform. So the topic of today's talk is humor, and I will be presenting a defense of humor, indeed, because as we all know, humor is a delight to the listener. It is a form of entertainment, and everyone amused, everyone wants to be in a blissful state that humor provides, that genre of comedy provides. But still, although it is a delight to the listener, but still the academicians and critics view humor with disdain, with much disdain. So I would like to present my topic in such a way that you can view humor and the genre of comedy with altogether new perspectives, with altogether new angles. And as you see, in the postmodern age, humor has changed its connotations. The genre of comedy, that re-manifestation of this emotion, humor, it has changed in the postmodern age. The anti-heroes have now become heroes in the comedy or in literary works with a comic tone. And you see the previous jesters, pricksters, madmen, half and comedians, they have now occupied a center stage from their state of margins. So that's why postmodernism is important as far as this journey of humor as an emotion and comedy as a literary genre is concerned. And I would also like to pay attention to some of the philosophical aspects of humor, the divine aspects of humor, and also the skeptical aspects of humor and how it has been seen by various philosophers. And yes, also the political implications of humor, how humor is politicized in the literary discourse by critics like Michael Buckton. So let us start with the presentation. Let me start the PowerPoint presentation. So is my PPT with?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, let us start with that. So I would like to start this topic with a beautiful and a colorful quotation by a famous Sufi mystic, Jalaluddin Rumi. And I think that you must be aware of him. He says that there are many ways to the divine, and I have chosen the ways of song, dance, and laughter. So what Rumi says here is that humor or laughter with all its connotations. Now, I would like to make it clear that in this presentation, I would be using humor and laughter with all their connotations, like connotations of carnivalesque and connotations of deviation and social inversion and role reversal and playfulness and the connotation of life force and emphasis on body. So humor will be used with all connotations, and song and they come under place. So he says that song, dance, and laughter, they could be a way towards reaching the divine. They could be a way towards realization of that divine light in all of us. Because you see, in many religions, like in Islam and in Christianity, I'm in the primitive Christianity and the fundamentalist aspects of Islam, they actually look at humor with disdain. Humor is something that will prevent you from reaching absolute, from reaching the supreme power. But Rumi denies this thing, and he says that there are many ways to the divine, and humor is one of them. It could be one of them. And then the next quotation is by a famous German philosopher and philologist, Friedrich Nietzsche. He talks about the in-betweenness of man. He talks about the dilemma through which the dilemma that man faces, the dilemma of in-betweenness that he is positioned in the middle of the great chain of being. So Nishay says that perhaps I know best why it is man alone who laughs. He alone suffers so deeply that he had to invent laughter. So Nishay also says that why man is miserable, why he is a sufferer, it's only because he is only social animal. He is a laughing animal. And why he suffers? Positioned in an in-between state, as also said by Alexander Pope in one of his famous writings, Essay on. What Pope says is similar to Nietzsche, and indeed Nietzsche has influenced in this thought the Pope. And he says that because man is positioned in the middle of the great chain of being, so that's why he is a sufferer. That's why he is always in a state of dilemma and confusion. And he can either be an angel or a devil. So he has to choose. And that's why he is always in a state of dilemma. So he says that what is the source of humor? Because man is only laughing animal. What differentiates man from other animals is laughter. Animals can't laugh, but humans can laugh. So that is what makes human beings human. So humor is very much related to humanity also. Now, humor is very much an integral part of human existence. Humor with all its connotations has expressed itself through art forms like dance, music, cinema. We all love comic movies, we all love comedians, and it has expressed itself through literature, through painting, sculpture, and theater. Indeed, in theater, humor is very important. Is very important, and how it is different from novel is because it has that spectacle in it. It has that audio visual aspect, and comedies and the emotion of humor, it is what prevents theater becoming boring and monotonous. So humor actually gives life to theater if we talk about plays. And humor is an expression of happiness that we called the divine state of being, the divine bliss, and through it one can achieve that divine light of humanity in man. So as I said, humor is equal to humanity, because only human being and a comedian and a humorist knows this thing, that okay, we are human, we have certain limitations, and it's okay that we are human beings and we have many limitations and many shortcomings. They actually celebrate this rather than lamenting it, like a tragic protagonist. The protagonists of comedy celebrate the shortcomings of human beings. And the famous humorist George Maix very rightly said this, that the humorist is a spoiled child who conceives the world as a gala place and refuses to accept the miseries of life. So, actually says that a humorous fact that this world is a place full of misery, and we are actually living in an absurd universe. Our existence is weird, it is absurd, but still accepts this fact. Smile on his face. So he has that element of flexibility in him, and that is what makes a humorist different from other people, or from people who have those of mental states and who are also short-sighted, who have that sort of intellectual myopia in them. So this word humor, it comes from Latin word humea, which means any bodily fluid or any liquid. And if you talk about the extended sense of this word, it means mood or a temporary state. Now you see, in Western theory, humor is considered as a temporary emotion, as a temporary state of mind. But if you look at the Natya Shastra, the Indian theory of knowledge, if you look at the Natya Shastra written by Bharat Muni, humor is a very important ras. It is a very important emotion, and it is counted among the eight emotions, among the eight rasas, flavors given in the Natya Shastra. Vidushak. Vidushak is the Indian counterpart of the Western clown or jester. And in Sanskrit dramas, he is a prominent source of humor. And he also acts as the main commentator. So you see in the Indian drama, more probably in Sanskrit dramas, Vidushak acts not only as the main commentator, but he also acts as a mediator who narrates the main action audience, and he acts as a mediator between the characters and the audience. So Vidushak, that brings about that democratic element in the Sanskrit drama. So Vidushak acts as a agent, as a democratic agent in Sanskrit dramas, because he acts as a mediator, as an intermediator, because drama is not something where only one-sided narration takes place. There are many people talking about certain themes, and they are voicing their opinions. And Vidushak, in this sense, who is a Western, who is an Indian counterpart of the Western jester, he acts as a mediator between the audience and the characters. Now, humor is a delight to the listener, but its role is not only limited to what we say entertainment. It's not only about humor. It also acts as a tool for deconstruction. Now, all of you must be aware about Jacques Derrida. Derrida, in his works, uses humor wittingly to critique the monolithic institutions and to critique the grand narratives of imperialism and racism and whatnot. It also acts as a therapeutic mechanism, because stress. And these days in metals, humor is also used as a medicinal technique. Clown is used as a medicinal technique in many hospitals. And in fact, there are many universities who are also offering various courses on, like the National University of Israel is offering courses on clowning, because the Israeli humor, or you see the Jewish old, and the Jews being a troubled whole world by the Christians and the Muslims alike. So they have devised their own technique of humor in order to prevent them from the external calamity, and in order to raise their soul towards the sanity of the enemies and the external world. So because humor is something that is very irrational, so different perspective on institute. A humorist, through his flight of fancy, can offer an alternate reality, a reality that is different from the reality that you see, from the reality that you immediately see in your surroundings. So a humorist can provide different perspectives on institutions, social, political, and religious institutions. So in this way, a humorist attacks the existing order of things, because he is not willing to compromise with the existing order of things. So through jokes and through other techniques of humor, like irony, and through satire, and through other techniques like melodrama, and through wits. So they attack the existing order of things. So humor change for social change. That okay, things are like that, and now they need to be changed. So humor acts as a therapeutic mechanism. It provides us relief and resistance, not only towards the absurd universe, but also it is against the monopoly of dominant social, political, and religious institutions. Social institutions like family, like marriage and religious institutions like the church or any religion, any institutionalized religion and political institutions. So because humor is things, it's a valuable cultural expression where it reveals social inequality. And because it questions things, because it wants change, because it stands in that zone of liminality where it questions things that are old and where it offers a step towards modernity, it is also subversive in nature. So because humor is doing all these things, it has that political implication, and it is also acting as a medicine, and it is also acting as a tool for deconstruction. That's why we can say that humor is not altogether something that is non-serious. It is serious also, and it can be put to serious uses. Serious uses in the sense that it can be used by the creative artists to question the nature of things, to question the grand narratives, and to question the center, the existing center. So it can be put this because it questions things that monolithic institutions that have become grand narratives. So it has those political implications also. And it is not something that is non-serious. It has certain serious uses also. And in this presentation, I would also like to deconstruct this word itself, that what is serious and non-serious. These are actually categories made by society, made by the powerful in society. Now, is humor unacademic? So, as I said in the beginning of CPT, humor has been discounted as something that is frivolous or merely a trivial light distraction in otherwise weighty literary works. Why? Because of its association with popular culture, because of its association with culture of working classes, with plebeian culture. Because humor is an important aspect of working class culture, of popular culture. So that's why it has been discounted as something that is frivolous, that is very trivial. And that's why, because of its association with plebeian culture, it is believed that serious can't be discussed in comic mode or comic tone. If you are a student and if you want to write a paper, a research paper, on a comic writer, then maybe your guide or maybe some others will say that, okay, why you have chosen this writer? What will you do with him? So this is the normal attitude to our comic writers. And although they are by all and they entertain us, and I think that actually, indeed, it is very difficult to do research on comic writers. Comedy is a very difficult genre for the actors as well as for the critics. But still, the academicians believe that serious issues can't be discussed in comic mode. You should pick up some tragic writer if you think reflective, something reflective and something heavy. So it is an important aspect of popular culture, and because humor us freedom to laugh, and because it provides access to knowledge, so it has become a very important prerequisite of any democracy. Now I would like to discuss these words, what I mean by access to knowledge and freedom to laugh. Let me start with the tune. Audible?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, you are audible.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, yes, so I would like to start with the classroom itself. Now, humor has become a very important aspect of classroom teaching. If a teacher uses humor in classroom, then he sounds more interesting and he can interact in a better way with the students. And these days we believe in the academy, these days we believe in the communicative model of teaching. Gone were the days when teacher just teach and students are only consumers of knowledge given by the teacher. But these days we believe in the communicative model of teaching where students and teachers are creators of knowledge and teacher is not some sort of a dictator or some sort of a master where he is only a mediator and students are just active participators in the process of knowledge. So humor is very important in classroom. This is one thing. And like there are certain expressions which become easy if you use humor. Like there are some writers willingly use difficult words and difficult expressions. There are many scientists and there are many kids, like the language of law and the language of science is a different language. It is a difficult language. It is not the language of the layman. So there are writers and certain critics and they will willingly use different words. So this process is called lexical terrorism in writer by Italian writer Dario Fo. He says that these writers will willingly use difficult words and difficult expressions and they will project an aura of seriousness in order to terrify people. In order to show them that, okay, you are different from us. We are a different category and you are a different category. So through humor, a literary artist can interact in a better way with the readers and with the audience. So that's how humor provides access to knowledge. Because in a humorous language, in a colorful language, knowledge is easily accessible to the readers and to the audience. And, as we all laugh, we are human beings and we have a right to laugh and freedom to laugh and access to knowledge. They are defining features of any democracy. So in that way, humor is subversive also because through its color and through its madness and through its playfulness, it can actually question the existing name. And because humor is irrational, you can't explain a joke because jokes are context-based. And if there is one, some people will it and some will not, and you can't explain. If you try to define it, it will lose its appeal. The moment you try to, the moment you try a joke, it will lose its appeal. It will lose that. Humor is by nature very amorphous and very irrational. And in that sensibility of humor, irrationality of the comic is used by certain writers, certain theoreticians to question the rationality, to question the order of so-called ordered institutions, like marriage as an institution has been created to impose order on society. Religion has been made to impose order on society. But in the postmodern age, all these have been treated as grand narratives. Whether they are social institutions or whether they are religious institutions or whether they are political institutions like imperialism and racism and the current politics. So these things have been made to create some sort of, to impose some sort of order on society. But actually what they are doing, they are creating disorder in society. So they are not doing in a rational way. So the misrule and the madness of humor, the irrationality of humor is used to counter the so-called rational social, political and religious institutions. Now let us look at origins of comedy. Comedy was considered as an inconsequential form of drama meant only for light entertainment, leading to the catharsis of emotions. And as a genre, it had been officially recognized at the festival of Dionysia in Greece since 486 BC, 40 years or so before Aristophanes was born. Aristophanes was a famous Greek comedian, and he was the father of comedy. He is credited with development of many aesthetic techniques of comedy and thus opening its way into the literary discourse. And what he did in his plays, he lashes at despotism and tribal militarism. And although his satires influenced political events of his times, he was more interested in belly laughs. So basically, Aristophanes was a popular writer, although he was attacking the political institutions of that time, but still he was more interested in entertainment. His main purpose was to entertain the audience, and politics comes after that. And in his comedy, Strata, he portrays a world turned upside down. Like in Strata, you can see wives having sex indefinitely from their husbands. Like this is not possible in real life, but through this comic lens, through this comic mode, he can portray a world topsy-turvy, a world that is topsy-turvy, which can happen. So what the comedies of Aristophanes symbolize? They symbolize the eternal conflict between father and son. And what father and son symbolizes in Aristophanic comedies, father represents the creation, and the son represents the father represents the creator, so the eternal conflict between the creator and the creation. Now Eric, one comedy critic, and he compares the conflict, this conflict represented in Aristophanes, to James Frazer's Men of a New King ritual, in which the old king is slaughtered, symbolizing the rejuvenation of the old year. And he employs rejuvenation motif in almost all his plays, where old man becomes a youngster. And after Aristophanic comedy comes the comedy of Menander, and his comedy is called New Comedy because Aristophanes wrote about political issues and Menander wrote about domestic issues. So Menander's comedy is called Domestic Comedy. And there are many stereotypical characters in the comedy of Menander, like crankers and hyperventilating young lovers, blustering slaves. So basically comedy deals with stereotypical characters as compared to tragedy, which deals with round characters. So comedy may deal with disquieting material, but finally it explores and celebrates the image of play, that okay, this life is just a play, and we should not feel rebel at the cruel hands of life. It's just a play and we should play on. It adopts a more flexible approach towards the absurd problems of existence. Tragic heroes are an experimentation of every kind, but comic protagonists, they view life as a series of mirrors and edges. And comedy embodies the conviction that the unknown will turn out to be at least as good as the known. So comic protagonists are flexible. Why? Because they have certain comic virtues in them. They love, they laugh, and they believe in misrule. They are a little bit mad. And it's made possible because they embody a greater appreciation for the muddiness of human nature, for the confusive nature of things that are world. Now, both comedy and tragedy with the same fundamental problem, but comedy depicts the world in an object, and comedy may deal with all sorts of dark things, but finally it celebrates world as it is. So it is more flexible way of treating things. And jokes are all context specific, and humor is something that is very objective, and because of its objectivity it is more close to spirituality. Because being a spiritual person, you look at things from a disinterestedness. That thing is also given in the Bhagavad Gita, that you need to participate, you need to observe everything, but with a sense of objectivity. And this humor is also about that. So I think that it is more close to spirituality rather than tragedy as a genre or other genres. Now, Conrad Ayres, he has written a book about creation, and he says that he has also written something on, says that in the culture in which tragedy was born, the highly praised virtues were those of a good commander, soldier. Older civilizations were tribal, and mental inflexibility on the part of the tragic protagonist could work in a tribal society, but in today's democratic society, such values hardly work. So he says that even in Greek times, comedies were done simultaneously with tragedies to ridicule and obedience to authority. So what humor does is that it questions unthinking obedience to authority, because it poses its reason in everything. Similarly, John Morrill has written a book, Comedy Tragedy, and he also gives a defense of comedy against tragedy. Comic vision is anti-militarist and often pissed. They have lampooned the willingness to kill or die on command. Comic protagonists are not willing to kill or die much, if anything. They are usually good at talking their way out of place, and when that fails, they are not ashamed to run away. So what a comic artist or what a humorist or a comedian do is that he acknowledges this thing, that as human beings, if we can't rise high, if we can't become Icarus, if we can't fly high, then at least we can sink below. There should be no shame in that, because we are all human beings, full of limitations, full of shortcomings. So as a genre, comedy grew out of fertility rights, and it emphasized basics in human life, like food, sex, and getting along with family, friends, and even enemies. It is the question of survival for a comic writer. Now, let us look at the aspect of comedy in the academy. Comedy as a genre entered into the academy. So the first significant modern attempt to make serious object of study appeared in 1914. MacDonald confers the origin of Attic comedy. So this person is MacDonald Confort. He has written a book, The Origin of Attic Comedy. So it's a combination of literary criticism and anthropology that reconstruct the sources and forms of the original comic entertainment. And he analyzes the structure of Greek old comedy, Phoenic comedy, and discusses its ceremonial roots. And then he also emphasizes the aboriginal relationship between comedy and the religiously sanctioned revelry and fertility beliefs that come from Dionysian and phallic rituals. And in his book, in his study, he notices that agrarian rituals, beginning with simple chants and songs, slowly they developed in form and complexity until they had become in sort of significance that led to prepared and stylized activity growing in their countries. Now, a phallic procession or a parade of phallic symbols is also a characteristic ritual of that, and it uses profanity and sexual and scatological imagery, means imagery related with excreta and all those things, as a kind of magic to protect the community. And he notices that in attacking bad behavior, old comedy follows the principle of magical abuse of the phallic procession, where phallus is used as a not only a defense against evil spirits, but also an agent of fertility and new life. Comedy as a literary genre creates rejuvenation. It celebrates new life. And it also celebrates destruction. So let us add the postmodern reflections of the genre. In the postmodern age, comedy has become an amorphous genre. Why? Because there are many new comic forms which are not directly related to each other, or which do not follow the methodological principles of comedy, like pantomime, sitars, sitcoms, caricatures, and slapstick comedy. all of them come into the category of comedy, although structurally each one of them is different. So I would also like to discuss a little bit about these words. What is comedy? What is humor? What is laughter? Comedy is a literary manifestation of the emotion which is called humor. And the comic is that spirit that identifies in something, that sort of incongruity, that becomes the comic. Like all of you are students of literature and you must have gone through the comedies of thesis plays of Bernard Shaw. So in his plays, there is no physical laughter, or there is no that sort of entertainment or amusement, but still they are called comedies. Why? Because they have that sort of incongruity in them, the distance between the real and the expected in society. So that's why his plays are called comedies, although they are very, very serious. They are called because they discuss some important topics of society, and the characters of Bernard Shaw actually are the spokespersons of his opinions. And laughter is a physical manifestation of humor. Postmodern age, comedy, this word, has become a tone, a structural genre. Because there are many writers, you see, in the 20th century, in the postmodern era, like the American novelist John Barth, and Thomas Pynchon, and Christopher Durang, they can be aptly said as black humorists, because they willingly incorporate all those techniques from folk culture and from the genre of comedy to critique certain grand narratives. Like Thomas Pynchon, in his plays, he critiqued the grand narratives of imperialism and racism. And his material from conspiracy theories, as well as from folk art, from graphic novels, from comic strips, from all sorts of different material. So although their works are very serious, and indeed they are very dark, they are considered as very dark writers, their way of portraying things is comic. Their way of portraying things is through the platform of humor. So that's why in the postmodern age, where humor is also used in so-called dark literary work, it has become a tone rather structural genre. Now in the postmodern, we look at comedy not from a structural perspective but from a tonal perspective. So in the postmodern age, all discussions and all analysis on comedy, they are open. Why they are open-ended? Because there is an absence of adequate methodology to discuss comedy. Because comedy is a very thing, and because of absence of adequate methodology to analyze it, sometimes comedies are, and of course because of its association with popular culture, sometimes it remains underrated. But this is not the case with the postmodern age. In the postmodern age, we are equally giving respect to comic writers also. Like we have Salman Rushdie. He is a winner of the Booker Prize, and he has willingly used humor, a humorous tone in his novels to critique, to satirize the grand narratives of and imperialism and religion. Now comic, the humor, it works like language. Like the discourse of language is unfinalized. The more you try to arrive at a meaning in a sentence, meaning in a language, it gets deferred. The meaning gets deferred. It gets postponed. And arrive at a final meaning. So the comic is also like that. Languages are plural and you can't arrive at a final meaning. So in the comic also, in a joke also, you can't arrive at a final meaning. The meaning gets deferred. And I would like to quote one statement by Jean Francois Lyotard and Giles Deleuze. He says that like laughter, like desire, laughter is also fluid and can't be contained by rational. And that's how it has become an important tool for deconstruction. Now, people who are against comedy, that whether comedy is celebratory or whether subversive, we can't understand that. It is because comedy has become a politicized zone of ideological struggle. Sometimes it is celebratory of the old customs, it celebrates life, and sometimes it is subversive of customs, it wants certain modern things, questions the existing order of things. So it has become a politicized zone of ideological struggle. Why comedy has been politicized? Because we can't say that whether it is subversive or whether it is celebratory, whether it is reinforcing the status or whether it is questioning the status quo in the society. So that's how comedy lies of liminal zone of illness, with all its connotations, like it is playful with the theme of madness and deviation, distance, role reversal, carnivalesque social inversion, life force and emphasis on body. It lies in that zone of liminality. Now let us understand what we mean by comic element in literature. So as far as literature is concerned, comedy or the comic, it signifies the concept of flux in the universe. That okay, this universe moving, everything is moving, nothing is constant, and what is existing today will change the other day. So we should accept this flux, we should accept this movement. So comedy is about this movement and it celebrates it. And that's why comedy has become a parameter for the progress of civilization. Civilizations that do not allow a comic spirit to flourish are actually dead, and they are not worthy of questions. So it is only humor and the comic appeal that maps, that measures the progress of any civilization. And you see, mainly Saturnalian. Saturnalian comes from Roman gods Saturn. Roman societies, in Roman religion, Saturn stands for rejuvenation, and it stands for the time of sowing the seed for fertility. And on the 17th of December, every Roman people, they celebrate the festival of Saturn, which is called Saturnalia. And this word Saturnalian comes from Saturnalia, where gifts are freely changed and certain moral codes, certain religious codes were they are eased, and slaves in the previous society, today there are no slaves, but when this festival was celebrated, in the medieval in the Roman countries, so gifts were freely exchanged on the Saturnalian celebrations, and certain religious restrictions were also eased, and slaves were given certain freedoms. So all sort of comic experiences Saturnalian in the sense that it celebrates rejuvenation, it celebrates change, fertility, and it celebrates that topsy-turvy of things, when the new will become old, and there will be new things in the society. Now, as far as our literature syllabus is concerned, we come across these terms, like what is high comedy and what is low comedy. So high comedy is basically intellectual comedy in which laughter comes not from physical act, from horseplay or from slapstick, but it comes from the incongruity of situations. It comes from the mismatch of situations. And low comedy, entertainment is utmost important. And in low comedies, like the comedy of Charlie Chaplin, and high comedy, Bernard Shaw's comedy comes under the category of high comedy. Because in Bernard Shaw's comedy, there is no slapstick and horseplay, but the comic spirit comes from the mismatch between things, certain ideals created by the writer and what is happening actually in the society. And in low comedy, laughter comes from violence and from excessive physical activity and from horseplay and slapstick. Now, it acts as a broad genre of film, television, and literature. And of course, TV serials like sitcoms, they provide social commentary on existing issues, and they want to reform society. And entertaining comedies, they give a sort of comic cathartic. And so there are certain comedies which are called black comedies. They are based on a very serious condition, but still they are called comedies because of their methodological, because of their structure. So why they are called dark comedies? Because they arise out of that sort of human sadness, misery of the world. And in order to give a shock to the audience, they use certain tools like melodrama and farce in order to shock the audience, in order to shock the audience from their daily complacency, from their daily ritual. Like we all follow that sort of daily ritual in our lives. Like now we are in the office and we will return to home, and most ladies look after the home, and then awake in the morning, and we will come to the office, and then again this mechanical living. So in order to shock the audience from complacent existence, from their mechanical, they willingly use elements of melodrama and slapstick and farce to give a shock to that they can awake from their daily ritual, from their mechanical living. Now, there are many types of comedy, like situation comedy, in which comedy is incorporated in a narrative, romantic comedy, in which there is a hero and a heroine, and there is a conflict between the ideal situation envisioned by the couple and the hard realities of life that they come across. And after that, in the end of romantic comedy, that conflict resolves and it ends happily. In slapstick, there is more of violence and physical humor. In farce, farce is also similar to slapstick. In farce, there are exaggerated situations. There is also violence. And in dark comedies, the subject matter comes from some sort of very dark experience, like the experiences of war, experiences of Holocaust. Gallows humor is also a part of that. Like in gallows humor, or you can say army humor, military humor, in which soldiers make fun of their bosses, they make fun of their dictator agents to relieve themselves from the fear surrounding them. And then there are parodies, and they are also called, in which through music or through any other techniques, you imitate the style of a literary writer or a work. That is also called spoof. Then there are stand-up comedy, and then there is comedy of manners. Yeah, comedy of manners can see their faces in the mirror of comedy and reforms. And in a stand-up comedy, there is a comedian standing and he has certain magical tricks and certain props, and he cracks some jokes, and he is actually directly interacting with the audience. So there are various types of comedies. Now let us discuss certain theorists of humor. There are many theorists in the century, and they have written extensively on the use of humor, how it is related to humanity. Like one is J.B. Priest, and he compares thinking with feeling, and he says that humor is something that relates thinking with feeling. He says that Humor is thinking in fun, feeling in earnest. And then there is Stephen Leacock, the important Canadian humorist. He says that comedy bases itself on the of life. It finds its basis in congruity of life itself. Laughter and tears become one, and humor becomes the contemplation and interpretation of life. Then there is Arthur Koestler. He calls comedy as a sort of intellectual gratification. And then there is Leonard Feinberg. He calls comedy as a playful aggression. Then there is Abraham Lincoln. He says that I laugh because I must not cry. So he associates pain with sadness. And he says that in order to laugh, crying is important. If you never have cried, then you can't laugh also. So he associated pain with sadness. Then there is P.B. Shelley. In one of his poems, he says that before and after, and pine for it is not. Our sincerest laughter with pain is fraught, and our sweetest songs are those that tell of thought. So he also relates pain and pleasure. As William Hazlitt, and he says that comic is actually the combination of various unrelated ideas, the contrast of ideas. And Fry says that comedy or satire is a militant irony. A satirist is actually uneasy with the world and wants to change the existing order of things. So in a satire, there are certain moral absolutes, the absolute. You assume standards against which you measure things. And a satirist is actually an angry man that wants to reform the mankind. There are various associated theories of humor, old theories and new theories, and we will quickly discuss these theories, like superiority theory that views humor as an anti-social force. Like old Greek philosophy and in Bible, low status has been given to humor because they think that humor or comic is something that is irrational and we should pay attention to the rational thing. Like Plato in his famous Republic talks about comedy in a bad light. He says that there is a part of you which wants to make people laugh, but your reason restrains it because you are afraid of being thought a vulgar clown. Nevertheless, you let it have its way on those other occasions and you don't realize that the almost result of giving it energy in this other context is that you become a comedian in your own life. So in his Republic, he wants to create ideal citizens for the Republic. And in Republic, there is no place for a comedian and there is no place for comedy. Now, early Christianity was also against humor and because they believe that any person who laughs too much is certainly influenced by some sort of animalistic of flesh. So early Christianity was also against humor because, and in fact, in women, it was damnable. A woman can't laugh. And during the 5th century, laughter was considered as the grossest of the rule of silence and humility. And laughter was considered of filthiness, mouth as a filter against evil, and hence advised its protection from impurity. So the early church believes that because while laughing, there are certain movements of your face, so animals can enter your mouth, so you should not laugh at all. And Puritans in the 17th century, they followed the footprints of this monastic tradition because they believe in self-control and they oppose music and comedy of any kind. And this approach was changed during the medieval period. And during the medieval period, they differentiated between good laughter and bad laughter. Before the medieval period, they curtailed laughter altogether, but during the medieval period, they differentiated between good laughter and bad laughter. And they were so much obsessed with the question of laughter that whether or not Jesus had laughed in his early life, it enjoyed a vogue in ecclesiastical society so much that in the 13th century, the University of Paris organized an annual conference on the subject. So they were so obsessed with bad qualities of laughter that they were preoccupied with this question that whether our God gave importance to laughter or not. And during the medieval morality plays, Vice was a major character, and he was actually a comic character. Like in the morality plays, the Vice was a character who came on stage from to tell, and he was quite funny with lots of capering about, and he sings and he cracks various jokes. And he also uses scatological humor, I mean humor related with human excreta. And most often in disguise, as far as the characters on stage are concerned. So this character of Vice, he was in disguise. And it was the character, it was only that comic character, it was the character of the Vice that established a close relationship with the audience. And the character of the Vice, he addresses the audience directly. So if you talk about medieval plays, it was this character only that brings that sort of interaction and entertainment in the lifeless morality plays. They bring in the element of entertainment and spectacle, and it is only through the character of the Vice. Now, on the screen, you can see these seven deadly sins like anger, gluttony, envy, greed, lust, pride, and sloth. And all these seven deadly sins as comic medieval movie plays. And Howard Johnson, he's a famous comedy critic. He says that if there were no devils in the morality plays to expel, there would be no comedy to enjoy. As I said, the comic character actually introduced the element of play, color, action in the mechanical, monotonous morality plays. And during the medieval, it was considered essential to understand heaven. And then there are certain saints also, like Mother Teresa and Saint Philip Neri and Saint Thomas Aquinas. They gave importance to humor in their teachings. So this appropriation of laughter by the church is a result of that they have accepted laughter, but it has certain political implications. And why they have incorporated laughter in the religious canon? Because they want to interact with the folk. They want to empower folk arena. They want to enter into the folk arena and forcibly. They have to admit laughter. It's not by choice, but it's actually the demand of that time. Now, the medieval period identified the worth of laughter in understanding the pulse of folk culture. It is not because they have understood the old antagonism between flesh and soul. It is only because they want to into the arena of the folk. You see this picture. This is a picture of one feast, which is called Feast of Fools. And this feast was celebrated in the first week of January in the medieval period. And in this, the ecclesiastical order tries to enter into the folk arena. Are various characters in this picture. They are wearing masks. They actually presented this sort of spectacle where all the characters, they change roles, and one boy from the lower clergy will become bishop for one day, and the order will be changed. So they are actually playing this spectacle. They are only playing this ritual. The things have not changed actually, but they are only playing ritual. They are doing it ritual. They are doing it ritualistically. So it is a step towards entering into the folk arena by this little space. By giving this little space, they want to enter into the folk arena, and they want to of the. They want to get hold of the masses. Now coming to another theory is Henry Bergson's theory of the automaton. This is a 20th century theory, and this is actually the essence of the ridiculous is mechanical inelasticity, where someone acting in a rigid, repetitive instead of a flexible, context-sensitive way. So this theory gives rise to humor of the machine age. Humor of 20th century. And what is this humor of the machine age? Well, laughter comes out of that mechanical living, like laughter of Charlie Chaplin. Laughter of Charlie Chaplin is also a result of machine age. And then there are certain shortcomings of the superiority theory. And what is superiority theory? It is based on the presumption that why people laugh, because they think that the others are inferior to them, and in order to they laugh, and laugh is the result of that. And Stephen Leacock also says that laughter is the most elemental mechanism of human beings, and he says that the savage primitive who cracked the head of his enemy and shouted ha ha is the first humorist. The savage is the first humorist. So his lines are also superiority theory, that laughter comes, why we laugh on others, because we think that we are superior from them. Now superiority theory was okay, but it failed to see the angelic and blissful dimensions of laughter, and it also fails to understand the will to survive humorist. Now in modern medicine, there are certain writers like Hippocrates, Democritus, Jobert and Rabelais. They look at laugh mechanism, and then Suzanne Langer, she says the comic form is essential to survive, will to survive in human beings. Now the second theory is incongruity theory, and incongruity theory sees laughter as a result of certain sort of absurdity, ridiculousness. Like there is shortage of time, I would have read Dation by Joseph by one otherwise I would have read this quotation of Henry Fielding in the novel Joseph and Greaves. Well, like I must read it actually. The unformed or disproportionate are not humorous in them, but they may become so if they adopt an affectation. Like Henry Fielding in his preface to Joseph Andrews, he also gives the source. It is actually affectation of the person who is already deformed or disproportionate. Any ugly person is not laughable in himself, but he becomes laughable only when he affects that. So that becomes even more laughable. Like I would like to pay attention towards the image of Ganesh, Lord Ganesh, and incongruity also regarded as a source of humor in Natyashastra by Bharat Muni, and one example is Lord Ganesh. What does Lord Ganesh signify? He signifies deformity. He signifies the limitation of this universe. He is perfect. Then there are also certain shortcomings in incongruity. incongruity theory, the superiority theory, because laughter comes only not out of incongruity, but it will also come out of emotions like fear, anger, and lust. Then because of these limits comes the relief theory given by Sigmund Freud. And Sigmund Freud thinks that laughter is not a result of superiority. It is not a result of incongruity, but it is actually a result of division of human self. And it comes out from the unconscious of, the dark unconscious of human beings. And he says that laughter is not an evil force, but it is some sort of a nervous energy that will lead to equilibrium. The linguistic structure of jokes is a direct outcome of the programming in the unconscious. So Sigmund Freud attributes the source of laughter to division of human self. Human self is divided. And because it is divided, it needs equilibrium, and that equilibrium is bring about by laughter. So laughter is actually a medicinal, and it is not an evil force. It is a medicine. Then he also compares the process of joking dreams. Joking is a result of certain sub-desires like dreams. Like we usually dream of certain things that we can't do in actual life. So this is also a thing with jokes. So he, with dreams. And so he concludes that laughter is actually a benevolent force, and it's a relief mechanism devised by human beings to survive. Now, I would like laughter from a philosophic lens. Now, there are certain 20th century philosophers who have written extensively on the use of humor and the philosophical implications of humor, like Jean Baudrillard and Nietzsche and Jean Francois Lyotard and Jacques Derrida. And through their post-structuralist writings on humor, they have tried to incorporate the tenets of the comic into the philosophical thinking. Otherwise, before 20th century, before the postmodern age, laughter was treated as something that is very evil, very trivial, and very insignificant. Now, during the postmodern era, the status of the clown underwent significant change as the figure shifted from social, artistic, and academic marginality to center stage. And the humor, by its very nature, is amorphous, it is ambiguous, and so it helps in negotiating extremely sensitive and emotionally charged issues that lie in the zone of old and new values. Now, I would like to take you to the folklore, popular laughter, and literary discourse, because it will discuss the political implication of laughter. So it was actually Michael Button who introduced the realm of non-serious into the serious. And what he does is he politicizes laughter and employs it as an instrument to register victory over oppression. And he uses folk as the domain of laughter. So in his famous work, Rabelais and His World, he attributes a therapeutic function to laughter. And he writes about fair laughter, where he says that festive folk laughter presents element of victory, not only over supernatural awe, of sacred over death. It also means the defeat of power, defeat of earthly kings, classes, and everyone who oppresses. And so he actually politicizes folk laughter into the literary discourse. He says that officially the palaces, churches, institutions, and private homes, they were dominated by hierarchy and etiquette. But in the marketplace, Buckpin valorizes marketplace because he says that you can hear a special kind of laughter, a special kind of language in the marketplace. So what this language signifies is culture at ease, making fun of authority and officialdom, and openly violating, humiliating, and subverting officially designated rules of decorum, etiquette, and propriety. And among the carnival festivities, he also included the feast of food. And he says that these celebrations actually act as a space for oppositional practices. They are not only limited merriment and celebrations, but they have a political value also, because they become a space for oppositional practice, strengthening the voice of the working classes, voice of the so how marginality is linked with creation. It was only Michael Buckton gives a link between marginality and creation, and he says that marginality is actually a creative and a disruptive force, and it brings about resistance in society, it brings about subversion in society. And he says that carnival is not actually a sudden politically progressive force. Carnival will not suddenly bring about a revolution, but it will sow those seeds that will become trees in the future and motivate people to rebel, motivate people to question the existing order of things. Now read the statement by Howard Jacobson. He writes about jokes. A joke is a structured dialogue. A joke is a very important tool for deconstruction, because humorous statements are always potentially ambivalent, because assertions made within comic contexts are in under erasure, and their status is that of a little narrative. So Jacobson actually compares a joke the mini narrative can counter the grand narratives prevalent in society. So like postmodernism, humor or the it basks in a situation of in-betweenness. You can't measure humor, and this is all the same thing with postmodernism. Postmodernism is actually an extension of it, and also reaction against modernism. So this is the same thing with humor. Humor is actually a extension of the old as well as a reaction against old. And although humor is neither in liberating nor inherently conservative, and sometimes accused of being apolitical, but it has the potential to unveil the politics behind ideologies and monolithic absolute discourses. So whether humor is liberating or whether it is conservative, we should not be paying attention. But what becomes is important is whether it has that potential to unveil the politics behind certain systems, to unveil the politics behind certain narratives. And yes, it has that potential. Thank you so much. And I think that Raghavan sir.
Ma'am, yes ma'am, it was a wonderful presentation, ma'am. Thank you.
Okay sir, because I have cut short many things because you told you because you told me that I have presentation in 1 hour 30 minutes, and I would have liked to read some more quotations with the students, because only after reading you can get the main gist. But okay, I have discussed main points with the students that I wanted to discuss.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, Bini.
Thank you, ma'am. This meeting is now open for the discussion. If anyone has doubts or questions, please unmute yourself and ask your questions.
Difference between a novel and a drama, madam?
Sir, are you asking me the difference between novel and drama?
Yes.
So in a novel, a novelist is actually voicing his opinions through the narrative, directly related to the narrative. But in a drama, he is not voicing his opinions directly, but through the characters. Moreover, drama is more, I mean, colorful. It is more full of light. It has that audio-visual aspect in that. One important thing is that dramas are meant to be played. They are not meant to read in classes, but novel is for serious study. It is for serious. Drama is basically popular. Novels are not that popular. I think that is the main difference.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for sharing your knowledge. It was really a wonderful session.
And I would also like work. To, okay. Yeah, there was more yes, question. Yes. Someone asked that, is it a question? It's between tragedy and comedy. Someone asks me that whether it is a right tragedy or comedy. Well, I will leave this question to you. I will leave the answer to you because you are students of literature and you can act a comic play. And you can also act a tragic play and you can feel by yourself, which is more difficult. I think comic acting is more difficult than tragic acting. A tragic role is somewhat easy to play than a comic role because laughter is difficult. You can't laugh unnecessarily.
Good morning, ma'am. This is Ramamani from Trichy. Okay, I have a question, ma'am. Could you please elaborate on how carnivalesque is related to humor?
Actually, carnivalesque is a concept given by Michael Buckton, and this word carnival comes from a carnival, which is a festival. So carnivalesque is actually a literary mode in which there is fun and in which inversion of what is already existing, inversion of the social, inversion of the norms, and humor also does that. There is a little technical noise, I think. So I was talking about carnivalesque and humor, how both of these are important. So carnivalesque comes from market, from carnival. And this humor is a very important aspect of folk culture. Like if you pay attention to the dialogue, if you pay attention to folk forms like folk songs and folk stories, humor plays a very important role. Like Bhaktin talks about two types of language. One is language of the office, language of the church, and language of the marketplace. Carnivalesque is directly related to humor. Because humor is with all sorts of connotations, like playful is also a part of humor. When you are being yourself and you are playful, and when you appreciate all the colors of life, and it's also about those things. This word comes from carnival, and it is actually carnivalesque is a word used by them for novels. Those novels, there are multiple voices. There may be certain minor voices and certain major voices. The only existence of minor voices in the shows that the major voices or the dominant voices are not altogether dominant.
Thanks a lot, ma'am. Thank you for this.
So humor is not directly related to carnivalesque, but humor in all its connotation, what actually it represents, that is related to carnivalism. Otherwise, humor is just action, but it has its manifestations in many things. So that's how it is related to carnivalism.
Thank you, ma'am.
May I ask a question?
Okay, who is that?
Yeah, my name is Kavita Rathod.
Kavita.
Thank you, ma'am. First of all, it's been a topic, and you know, a marathon, 1.5 hours. I really appreciate your patience for this. Question is, you know, you have mentioned many writers who come under the category of you know, who write comedies and all that. How come we don't find in that list any women, especially? Your opinion about this, what do you, I'd like to know. How come, is it gender specific or don't figure into the list for writers who, you know, indulge in humor, comedies and all that?
Yeah, I think your question is very good and it's very reflective. Indeed, while writing my paper on humor, I also realized this thing that there are not many writers, there are not many women humor, women writers who indulge in this narrative of humor. It's only, yeah, it's very much gender specific because the society and the normative thing generally believes that, that a woman can't laugh. Because since the beginning of this civilization, a woman has been stereotyped and she has been compared with something that is very, I mean, that is very pure, or she has compared with body sometimes. And indeed, there are so many writers that one is, I forget her name. It's Wendy Wiesenthin is a American writer, and she actually talks about this thing that why there is this for women writers who have used humor. And yes, very much it is gender specific, because from the very beginning have been compared with something certain things that are very, that okay, you have to do this and you have to do that, and if you laugh then you will look different. And yes, it has not something, but it has much to do with the gender. It's a part of gender politics.
Thank you very much.
But in the postmodern age, many women writers are coming for, like in Indian writings in English, there are many writers and are actually coming out with their own versions of mythology. Like I think there is one writer, Poyali Sen Gupta, and she has rewriting on the character of Shurupnakha, and that has some sort of humor in it. So women writers are come at the present time, there is paucity of women writers who use this comic mode in their writers, but they are coming as they are breaking all stereotypes of slimness and others, that women is only body and all these stereotypes. Women writers are coming. They will mark their presence in the future to come.
Yeah, even in stand-up comedy, we find very few women who are stand-up comedians, right? On the
I think one other reason is that because comedy is something that is very ambivalent. Comedy is related to body. And these days, women are trying to surpass that element of body. They are trying to portray that, okay, we are not just body, we are also mind. Because yes, the old culture, they have related women only with body. And humor is also taking its content from the body. So sometimes in comedies, maybe it is the reason that few women writers are able to laugh at themselves. One reason is gender, and other reason is preoccupation with body.
Yes.
And I think that when women writers are able to laugh themselves, if some woman is breaking all those stereotypes, if she to laugh at herself, then I think she can write humorous stories in a better way.
Thank you very much, ma'am. You know, might be answered by you so well. Thank you so much. Such a lovely topic it is. New and unique.
Thank you.
Hello, ma'am.
Yeah, who is this? Vaishnavi?
I'm Vaishnavi Sana from Amaravati, Maharashtra. I'm just PG Parent now. And your session was wonderful. I would like to ask a question about... that means you have the corners of comedy, but know that nowadays, what is the status of common literature? And I would like to extend the question of Kavita ma'am. Professor says that you have a very humoric that means I can make comedy myself also and others also, that I can make them laugh. So what kind of characteristics keep in mind while we think to write comedy or humorous thing?
Look, Vaishnavi, these days, as I said, that humor has become more of a tonal genre rather than a genre. And there are many novelists also who have used all these techniques. It is not only limited to that physical laughter, ha ha ha. It's about certain other things like irony. So certain objective techniques like irony, you can exercise irony in your works as a literary writer only when you have that sense of disinterest towards things going on in society, when you have that sort of objectiveness. Humor is not only, this is the looking at humor, the new way of looking at humor is that how it is related with science, with irony, and with things that are not directly related to laughter as an expression. So these things have been used by some. Of course, not by women writers, but they have started. And I think that what you are asking is that how to become a good comic writer. Is that your question? Because you say yes. That you have good sense of humor.
Yes, yes, ma'am, absolutely.
Yeah, it is by remaining objective. And if you want to write a novel by using a third person perspective, I think that you can exercise that quality of humor in your work. It is by remaining objective, seeing things from a third person perspective. You can do.
Okay, ma'am. Thanks a lot.
So humor about objectiveness and disinterest. Rather just about physical laughter or just about entertainment. That's why I said that it is more philosophical than the genre of tragedy. And moreover, we live in a postmodern age in which there is nothing right or nothing wrong. So we have actually moved away from satire. Now actually, we are living in a satire age. In the postmodern age, we have shattered all narratives and we believe that there is nothing wrong and there is nothing right. There are no clear-cut categories of black and white. There are only gray areas. So I think that in such a postmodernism, even satire cannot exist. We are living in a age of postmodern. We are living postmodern satire, post satire, to invent new methodologies of humor, where there is nothing good and bad, because a satirist laugh at things that are bad. He has set certain standards that, okay, this is good. And whatever has moved away from that standard, he laughs at that, okay, you need to reform. But in the postmodern age, there are no clear-cut categories. You can't reform anything. You can't reform anything because the other person will say, okay, you are saying that I'm bad and this situation is breaking the norms, and who are you to say that? Because these days we believe that everything is based on ideology, and we have moved away from these things. So I think we have to devise altogether new ways to write satire, and indeed living in the post satire age, we have to devise a new methodology for satire. And that's why that we are giving more in the academy, we are giving more attention to folk literature. Because in folk literature, humor is very natural. In folk literature, you can see that there are no such categories of good and bad. It is just the natural dialogue of people, whether it is folk song or satire, and whether it is any folk. And that's how we are bringing into account all documents from popular culture, that we are also scrutinizing the spectator sports, and we are scrutinizing comic strips and short stories and all these things. So popular culture comes into account. It is not only a distinction between comedy and tragedy. Now it's popular culture. Now it is folk art. Now it is the marketplace. Now it is not only about written comedies or the genre of comedy. It is about culture. What cultural studies is about.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you. Thanks a lot. What is the status of comedy, ma'am, that means in literature nowadays? Where we are going towards the comedy?
Yeah, of course. We are anti-heroes. We are moving towards comedians. Like, if they are all full of anti-heroes. I mean, they have to, you know, present before you that you can, they are all breaking the norms. Those anti-heroes are breaking the norms. Now we have heroes from the common streets, and they are all full of humor. We laugh at them. In the earlier tragedies, you can't laugh at a tragic hero. You can't laugh at King Lear. I must not give example of King Lear, because King Lear is actually a comedy. One critic has said that Lear is actually a comedy, because sometimes Lear looks like a comic character. But you can't laugh at Othello. You can't laugh at tragic hero. But these days, when there are many anti-heroes in the movies, you can actually laugh at them. You can sympathize with them, because they are like you. Indeed, they are below you, and even then you are following them. So that is the trend. It is the trend of comedians at the center. Comedians being the heroes of cinematic discourses and literary discourses. Now we have no standards left in society.
Yes, ma'am. Absolutely right. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. Collective work is the secret behind the thank you is a prayer that has to be felt by heart. Now I invite Dr. D. Govan, Associate Department of English, to propose the word of thanks. Welcome you, sir.
Thank you, Bini. It was a wonderful session. Definitely we are enjoyed. A warm and graceful afternoon to our most honorable research person, the management, principal, working teachers, and parents, my dear friends, and everyone gathered in this forum. It's my privilege to propose, first of all, my most sincere thanks to the Almighty God for makes even the race only success. I extend a very hearty word of thanks to our guest, Dr. Monica Dillon, madam, who spared time from her busy schedule to grace this session. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, sir.
A special mention to our respected for Dr. B. Arugudan, at least nominated as students of the best and standing as pillars of. Thank you, sir, in his absence here. I extend my thanks to Dr. Mark Lady Sciences for her kind support. Thank you, ma'am. I extend my sincere thanks to Dr. Devendran, head of the department in charge, for his kind support. Thank you, sir. I thank my faculty members from my department. I am short of words for their involvement and their willingness to take on the completion of the task beyond their comfort zone. Next, I would like to thank the teachers from various departments, colleges, and schools for their participation. My sincere thanks to our students from various schools, colleges, for their active participation. My sincere gratitude goes to all the parents and well-wishers for solid support system and encouragement. Finally, I would like to thank Ms. Billy and Phoebe for the wonderful support by MOC, and also Ms. Susma and Mr. Nirmal, who made this event successful. Once again, I thank call. I thank you for attending this video. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for this wonderful session. And actually, students have asked very good. The session was really very interactive and very interesting.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
True to the original topic of humor.
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
The upcoming webinars are on 16th. Roundtable discussion, impact of spoken English by Roy Da Silva, principal, St. Stephen's School, Tongan. And on 17th, we have how poetry influences human and feelings during pandemic by Dr. Anita Sharma, associate professor, Department of English, Sri Shankaracharya Mahavidyalaya, Bihali. We expect your presence in these webinars also. Keep supporting us. We have come to an end of our webinar. I would like to thank everyone who made this webinar possible. Thanks for joining here us with in such a graceful manner and cooperation for the successful condition of the webinar. We will see next time. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, BB Susma, for the wonderful presentation here for our MOC. And thank you all, my dear friends and participants. Thank you all. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Ma'am Monica. Thank you, Ma'am Monica.
Okay, thank you all. I would like to thank you all students for such wonderful questions that really make the session interactive. Thank you, everyone.